Welcome to a virtual town hall meeting, the first ever coming to you from the Bronx with Senate Majority Leader Pedro Espada, Jr. Tonight, the Senator will be taking your questions live about the New York State budget. It's getting down to the wire just 10 days away from April 1st. I'm Julia Logandy, the moderator this evening. Senator Espada is the Senate Chairman of the Housing, Construction, and Community Development Committee. The Senator wants to hear your ideas and concerns before the 2010-2011 budget is voted on right here in the Senate chamber. Here's your chance to participate in the budget process. We certainly hope you do. So those of you watching us on BronxNet, Cablevision, or Fios can either call 1-800-930-9964 or log on to the Senator's website, espada.nysenate.gov, to reach out to us. Questions are also coming in by email, espadatownhall@gmail.com. Welcome, Senator. It's great to be here with you. Why do you think that this forum is so important?
It is so very significant, and thank you for the opportunity. It's significant to my district, to the Bronx. It's a historic occasion because the people of my district, amongst the poorest in the state, will have their opportunity tonight to directly give me their feedback. I am gone away from the Senate district because I'm up here negotiating a $130+ billion budget. They have to have their say. Tonight they get the opportunity to directly give me their best suggestions so that I could directly negotiate on their behalf. It's very empowering. It opens up a very close relationship with their senator, with their legislator, and with the negotiation process that affects so much in their lives.
Right, and questions have definitely been coming in. But before we get to them, I understand you have an opening statement.
I have an important announcement, Julia, because last year I was among those that oppose tolls on the major East River and Harlem River bridges. And this year, I must say I've changed my mind. But let me go back to last year first. Last year, the money that would have been generated from those tolls would have gone into the general fund of the MTA, an MTA whose finances we really can't grab a hold of. But this year, the MTA continues to have tremendous financial problems. And this year, the free student metro cards have been put to the budget acts. I am proposing here tonight that we have a $2 toll fare on the East River bridges, four of them, $2 each way, which will raise $525 million. I am only supporting that because it is a way to directly pay for the free student metro cards and alleviate any of the so-called cost savings that could be had by cutting subway and bus routes in the Bronx and throughout New York City. The MTA is of utmost importance not only to the ridership but to the economy of New York City. I also think that my proposal will have beneficial results with the healthcare status. The Bronx is among those that are the sickest in the United States of America. We have the worst health status in the United States of America. And this will help asthma rates, and it will help with all sorts of other problems as well. But mostly, I put my faith in the people of New York City to trust this proposal this time, because this time it will go directly to your children and to your grandchildren and help them get to school. I also have a firm belief that Chairman and CEO Jay Walter of the MTA has a great vision, and he needs the resources to work with. And so tonight I say let's give that vision and let's get these kids back on the tracks, on the way to school where they belong.
Thank you. Very good. Okay, so are you ready for your first question?
We're ready.
All right. This one is coming in and asks, fittingly, Governor, Lieutenant Governor Ravitch, where do you stand on Lieutenant Governor Richard Ravitch's recently submitted budget plan?
You know, Richard Ravitch is no stranger to me. I started out 30 years ago in healthcare, and he and I worked closely to develop the Soundview Healthcare Network. He is my landlord, and I as a 22-year-old then. So I've known him for a long time, and I thank him for his service, and I thank him for his proposal. There is much merit to many aspects of that proposal. The one thing I am not in favor of is borrowing to pay operating expenses. That is, if my wife and I are spending too much of our family budget and we go to the bank or we mortgage our house to pay for the daily expenses, we still have to pay that mortgage debt. We still have that on our monthly budget. And so it doesn't go away. And so I do not think that that is a way out of this financial crisis. It is a way of putting it off into the future and letting our children and grandchildren pay our bills. And so respectfully, I don't think that's a good idea. What I do think is a good idea is to borrow money for capital projects, housing. Let's build housing. Let's build 16 units of housing in the Bronx and throughout New York City and put 16,000 people back to work right away. We can do that. And so borrowing for capital expenditures, borrowing to build facilities like housing and other after-school centers that will keep kids out of trouble, these are things that put people right to work, and there's a real benefit to it. I think there are other benefits to the Ravitch proposal, and not only borrowing for capital expenditures, but also generally accepted accounting principles. That is, don't budget to pay what you don't have today. And money, tomorrow's money, you can't spend today. And those so-called gap principles will put us on a road to fiscal prosperity, I believe.
Okay. How about the state budget is due in 10 days? Do you think the budget will be passed on time? If not, when?
My Senate colleagues have been here Saturday, today. We've been here working and focused on getting a responsible, on-time budget. But better than an on-time budget is a just budget, a budget that really restores the kind of services that we have to have in order to, for working-class families to really prosper, to really survive this financial crisis. And so, yes, we'll try to get a budget in by April 1, but if we don't, a just and responsible budget is what we're targeting.
Great. Okay. This question was submitted through Facebook by Maria. Senator Espada, since the cap on charter schools raised to 400, is there a separate funding source for these schools in these dire fiscal times? Is it prudent to keep two public school systems operating?
Well, we thank Maria for that question. It's extremely, extremely important. We have an achievement gap. We have an educational gap. We have a million plus children in our school system that we have to educate. Charter schools are public schools. And Maria, we don't have 400 charters or licenses to give away. We have 200. And for every school that we open, charter school, there are lines of parents and children waiting to get in. And so we must lift the cap to 400, and we must move to give the capital resources and tuition assistance to those children that attend charter school, but mostly to the many, 99% of the children who don't attend charter schools and attend public schools. We owe them the tremendous commitment and obligation to restore educational aid and get them the kind of classroom sizes and quality teachers that their educational dreams deserve.
Great. Okay, here's another question from N. McIntosh. How will the state budget affect the tuition costs at SUNY and CUNY?
You know, during I'm of course came from Puerto Rico. I attended public schools. I attended Hunter College. I know what it is during economic difficult times to have a part-time job and go to school. Go to school at night, but go to school and continue my educational dreams. And that's no different from today's immigrants and from today's students, young and older students. During economic difficult times, they go to CUNY schools, they go to SUNY schools to advance themselves. And so we'll be fighting up here to make sure that the tuition rates stay at a very manageable level. And so we're fighting day in and day out for TAP students and from HEOP students. Those are the kind of financial resources that they need to have. But there are new proposals. And there are new proposals that will introduce differential tuition rates and all sorts of things that we're looking at very carefully to make sure that our minority students, blacks and Latinos, immigrants and non-immigrants, out-of-state students that come in to avail themselves of a first-class 21st century higher education, they come to New York from outside of New York. Perhaps they should pay a little more. But our first priority would be get those children and other adults that want higher education, make it affordable, make it within their grasp.
Okay. Okay. Questions are coming in. This one is by telephone. The caller didn't leave a name, but there's a lot of spaces in the Bronx, and could we build a... Let me start over. There are a lot of spaces in the Bronx, and we could build a lot of housing in there. It would be good for the economy and everything. I'm just calling to leave you that message. Do you want to
respond? It's a valuable message, and the reason we're having this show is because the best suggestions come from our folks who travel their neighborhoods to see opportunity. And yes, we have open spaces, and we have a great need for affordable housing. I am, as chairman of the housing committee and as a person that's been developing affordable housing ideas, I've been working with others, and we want $500 million in capital to get into this budget process, to be made available to build affordable housing throughout this state. We also have recently, as you may know and may have read, introduced legislation that would create for the first time a direct benefit to persons that earn $45,000 or less and make pay a third of that yearly income towards rent. We would freeze their rents, hopefully for a period of about 5 years, freezing the rents of over 300,000 households in New York City's five boroughs is our goal with this legislation. So the caller is absolutely right to identify the opportunity to build new affordable housing. We're going to work to do that through capital money, but I also want to preserve affordable housing and keep people in their homes because homelessness is not an option.
That rent freeze, you are adjusting that, correct? You're adjusting that legislation?
We are adjusting that. Just like Obamacare tonight will be passed, universal health care, we are going to be working the numbers, and we're going to be working with our colleagues because it is the right thing to do. So, yes, we're adjusting the numbers, but the reality doesn't change. The reality is that I've made a priority of getting relief to 300,000 households to try to do something with folks that make $45,000 or less or pay a third of that towards their rent. It's far too much. We need to freeze it. We need to help them directly.
Right, and it shows that you're really listening to what your constituents are saying.
Listening, acting, and leading, yes.
Absolutely. Okay, there are many messages coming in, so bear with me. Your district office has been hearing from parents quite a bit with concerns about safety for their kids and after-school programs. Could you talk about both?
You know, I'm so very proud that I've been able to get over $2.7 million of legislative initiatives into my community. But first, you know, $2.2 million this year. We put it into libraries, we put it into summer youth programs, we put it into economic development activities, about $100,000 into economic development activities, $450,000 into youth after school centers. This weekend, right in my neighborhood, we had the tragedies of having a father going into trying to defend their children, and he was shot. Two women, or young girls, 15 years of age, on Tremont, in a park in Tremont, enjoying the beautiful weather that we enjoyed this weekend, are in the hospital, one shot in the leg and the other in the shoulder. And again, a good Samaritan stabbed to death because he was helping break up a fight right at Fordham University across the street from my district office. And so this is the problem and the tragedy of having idle youth, of having no regard for human life. But the solutions are to take many steps, and to take many steps to have children involved in after-school programs, parents engage with their children so that they can understand the value of life and getting weapons and guns off the streets.
Absolutely. This message comes in from the 800 number. The person didn't leave a name, but wants to know, you know, there are people in the district worried that local hospitals and nursing homes will have to close if the governor's proposed cuts are passed. Is this true?
Yes, they should worry. And the alarms are going off because our public safety net hospitals, Lincoln Hospital, Jacoby Hospital, North Central Bronx, these are vital service providers who accept everyone. I underscore, they accept everyone, regardless of their insurance. They're uninsured. And so these institutions, they don't refer them out. They take them through their emergency room. They take them in for their inpatient care. They treat them and make them better. And this is their job. This is their public health mission. And so first and foremost, yes, the current budget would hurt those health and hospital corporation public hospitals. And I have been visiting with all of the CEOs, and we know that we have to protect that safety net for the people that are uninsured and have no other source of inpatient care. But after 30 years of being involved in healthcare, I can tell you that we're doing much more. We're dealing with the issues of obesity. The obesity crisis in our community affects adults. Clearly, diabetes, we're ranked among the top, a cardiovascular disease, and it is time that we focus in on our children. We have children that come into some of my medical centers, the Soundview Healthcare Network, that I founded 30 years ago, and they have cholesterol levels that you would think are in the bodies of 50 and 60-year-olds. Mm-hmm. They're weighing 300 pounds at age 9 and 10. And so what we're looking at is the problem that adults used to have, now children have. We have an obesity epidemic. And so some of my proposals will have us have fruits and vegetables, free fruits and vegetables delivered to our children, to our families in our neighborhoods. We will have a program that will deal with prevention and nutritional assistance. There are laws and resources behind my initiatives. And so, yes, we see that prevention is really what needs to happen. But in the meantime, we need to protect the hospitals and healthcare providers that we have, not only because of the tremendous job they do in healthcare, but let me just say straight out that without the healthcare industry, most all of the Bronx would be unemployed. Most of the full-time, quality-paying jobs in the Bronx with benefits, about 36% to 40% of them are in the healthcare industry. So when we support the safety net hospitals and healthcare in the Bronx and throughout New York City, we're supporting quality and affordable healthcare, but we're also supporting jobs.
Okay, this next comes in from Jose. What, if any, help is going to be given to recent college students that have to begin paying loans but are having trouble finding a job in this market?
Jose, you know, I want you to call my office, and I want a lot of the constituents that are dealing with these issues to call my office. We work on job development strategies every day. But he's absolutely right. We have the Armory, which is about the size of three football fields in my district. We have to develop that as an local economic engine in our communities. But I started out, my father and others in our generation started out with bodegas, grocery stores, laundromats, small businesses. And so my job creation strategy, and I applaud the governor for including a real emphasis and priority in this budget on job creation. We have to have the ability to develop those dreams that people walk around with, to develop a small business, 6, 8, 10 jobs, locally based, hiring people from their communities. This is what millions of dollars should flow to, and this is the kind of effort that we have to see demonstrated in this budget. Small business loan assistance, and we're not going to be alone there. The state, the city, and yes, the federal government, President Obama, has declared assistance in small business loans and capital there to develop those jobs locally.
Okay. This next one is from Alex. All over the news, you hear about Governor Patterson's proposed health care cuts. As a health care worker, I want to know what the Senate is planning to do.
The Senate is looking to preserve quality and affordable health care, as I mentioned. You know, it's easy to point a gun at the governor or anyone that's trying to deal with a $9 billion cut. And what I'm trying to develop here is not a focus on cuts, but a focus on where can we find money? Where can we find revenue generators? For instance, one of my ideas, and it's not just mine, people up here have talked about it for a long time, but we need to take action. There are museums, there are universities, there are endowment funds, there are big healthcare providers in the city, medical academic institutions that pay no taxes. And the Constitution of the state of New York does not allow for property taxes onto nonprofits. But we can have payments in lieu of taxes. Think about it this way. If you own a home that you pay a $300,000 mortgage on the corner of 203rd Street, and Montefiore Hospital, who I love and I support, but has hundreds of millions of dollars in revenue, and hundreds of millions of dollars in property assets, if they buy that home from Pedro and Connie on the corner of 204th Street, a two-family home, there's no property tax for them. But Pedro and Connie paid property tax, and we don't make $100 million a year. And so it's only fair that we start looking, not only in New York City, but statewide, for everyone to pay their fair share. And if we did that, billions of dollars would flow in. There's so many other ideas that we need to not just focus in on cutting. Yes, we should structure our budget and get our house in order. But there's also a lot of people and entities that are not paying their fair share. And we want those ideas as well.
Okay. This is going really well. A lot of people seem to be participating.
Keep calling. In Spanish and English, whatever you do, keep calling.
That number is 800-930-9964. This one is from Alma W. Thank you for the $200,000 to Davison Community Center to fight obesity in our community. How else will the budget invest in our children?
I think that's so important. And Davison Community Center has been around for 30 years, providing a number of great services to the Burnside community, to my district. We have a number of initiatives that will serve not only the youth and others in the community, but let me talk about seniors for a moment. We are very confident that we'll be able to save almost every senior center in New York City. But we just don't save them. We need to enhance them. And the way we enhance them is by giving them more resources to work with. In my legislative initiatives, I've been going around talking to senior directors, and we're trying to get them additional assistance. Among the many people that go hungry first are seniors. And we don't need any more stories about seniors eating dog food or seniors being famished because they don't have a secure food budget. And so part of my initiatives is to go out there and make sure that seniors have enough to eat. Fruits, vegetables, and other food would be available through wonderful organizations like Davison, but directly to senior centers who offer breakfast and supper meals. And without that, think about a long weekend when senior centers are closed. Where would those seniors eat? And we're talking about very poor seniors in the Bronx and many communities throughout New York City. And so these legislative initiatives would be targeted at making sure that those meals, not just on wheels, are going to apartments, but also there at senior centers where seniors go to socialize.
Okay. This next one is, for people in the district, can you talk about different services offered in your district offices, and how can we get in touch with you?
I would want them to please call my Bainbridge office at 718-652-4329. And we also have a Fordham office at 400 Fordham Road, 718-220-5480. My office is fully staffed with people that want to handle every concern of daily living that constituents have. And by the way, you don't have to be registered to vote. You don't have to be a citizen of this country. You have an issue. You walk into any one of my offices, you call us. Many of our staff are lawyers. They can refer them for legal assistance. They can refer them out or take direct action on their behalf. A lot of our constituent concerns are around housing. A lot of it are around jobs. Whatever the concern, please avail yourself. Call us. Our staff is trained, again, at Bainbridge, 718-652-4329, and at Fordham, 718-220-5480. And I have two offices, and I have additional resources because the good citizens of the 33rd State Senate District and my colleagues here have gave me the blessing to be a majority leader. And what that means is that one of the poorest state senate districts, the poorest state senate district in the state, can have additional resources because they need them.
Okay. This next one is someone that didn't leave their name, but as a small business owner, I have struggled to get financing for future projects. What, if any, can I expect in the future?
I think we have to, as I previously stated, we have to declare this priority number one in terms of economic development ideas. That gentleman with a dream in his pocket, others with a bag full of dreams are walking around every community in New York City, immigrants and others that know and want to develop a small business. I'll give you an example. I went to visit a young man the other day, and he manufactures appliances, refrigerators and stoves, and he was wondering, why is it that he can't get a break from anyone in state government? And we're giving tremendous priority and emphasis on women and minority-owned businesses. That is really where we have to focus our attention, because we are fast becoming a majority. And we don't have the opportunities that state government promises to give, city government promises to give through their procurement process, and they can't get in the door. So what does that mean? That means that we have to give opportunity to those like the caller who says, I have a small business. I want to do business with the state. Here in New York State, about 5% go of the state's contracting resources, which is hundreds of millions of dollars, goes into minority and women-owned businesses. A state like Florida has about a quarter of its business is dealt with minority and women-owned businesses. What does that mean? It's not political correctness. It means that it goes right into those communities that need the jobs, 5, 10 jobs at a time, and that's how we develop our economy. That's how we create jobs. That's how we transform families. And so we want to do more of that. Stay in touch with our office. But firstly, understand that many of us up here are following the leadership of a state senator in the Bronx, Senator Hassel Thompson, who has introduced legislation that will correct the injustices and give absolute authority to the state agencies to do business with our women and minority-owned businesses in our neighborhoods.
We are halfway through the forum.
Great.
And we've been getting a lot of input, but I just want to remind everyone how they can participate. By phone, it's 1-800-930-9964. Or you can email the senator at espadatownhall@gmail.com. Or you can go to his website, espada.nysenate.gov. All right, you ready for the next question?
We're ready. Did a little water, and we're ready to go.
We're ready. Okay. How does the state budget process work?
The governor, through the great constitution of the state of New York, has the first shot to propose. And the legislature, we dispose. We take that budget, and there is an assembly, assembly persons who serve right down the hallway. We are the Senate, 62 of us here, Republicans and Democrats and Independents, and we all have committees that we participate in. Again, mine is housing, but I have 6 other committees that I work in. And we take the budget apart, literally. But about 60% of the budget is in health and education. And so of the 100%, $134 billion, we look to have no new taxes, unless they're responsible taxes by folks and entities that had not paid their fair share in the past, and we're going to look at those, and we're going to set task forces up, and we're going to ask people to please contribute. When we say share the pain, then we want everyone to share the pain and the gains of our efforts. But in this budget process, we have public hearings. The great chairman, finance chair, Senator Carl Krueger, has had budget hearings, and we have this kind of input tonight, where people can call in and share their ideas. But at the end of the day, by April 1, we have a deadline. And we have a March 31st deadline for the end of the fiscal year. There is some talk that perhaps we should move that down further to the end of June. And by the end of June, a lot of times we know how much money we have from the taxes that are paid. By the way, before I forget, Governor Patterson, please get this money out. The tax refunds belong to the people. This is not some kind of expenditure or appropriation from state government. They've already paid. Now they get the refund. They don't need to wait for those refunds. So we have to get that money right out. And those of us who feel very strongly about that want to pass the law to make sure that this kind of predicament is not does not happen in the future. But back to the budget, we meet on weekends, we meet till midnight hours, and we talk about how to deal with this deficit. You know, it's not just a New York deficit. Every state in this union has faced the same problems. The Great American Recession, we call it. But in fact, it's a worldwide recession. I mean, goodness, China's doing really bad now. All right, Japan, who we used to look up to. So it is something that is worldwide. But right here at home, we could come up with the best solutions. Some of it, again, Julia, some of it comes from the people that live the life and work and talk the talk, and they know what we should do. There's been a communication gap. And so we don't want a top-down approach to the budget. We want a bottom-up approach to the budget. We want to take this budget and make it very public and have people get their input in here so that we don't sit up here in Albany saying, well, this won't hurt too bad to that hospital or that school. Yes, it does. And we don't live in that classroom. And we don't know what teachers have to do. Or we don't live on welfare, where the welfare grant hasn't increased in about 30 years. And the cost of living has increased every day. And so this is why the Senate Democratic Conference, Majority Conference, wants to make the budget process the democratic process. A process that is bottom up, and that's where we're going to take the lead, is in listening to people, in passing no new taxes that hurt the everyday citizen, and coming up with the new kinds of ideas to save the student metro card so that $500 million will come out of this budget process, we hope, by having tolls on the bridges that I previously opposed because it would go to a general fund. But today, I was given the opportunity, and I'll repeat the announcement I made earlier, that we have to have the money for those kids to go to school. And tolls on the four East River bridges will yield us $525 million. We can put that LinkedIn lockbox so that those kids can get to school. It will help the health of the New York City community in terms of pollution, and it will also help increase ridership. When we increase ridership, we increase revenues, and everyone will share the profits of that.
Okay. You know, as a follow-up to the question, the budget process, what do you think of the Lieutenant Governor's proposal to change the fiscal year to July 1st? And you already spoke about that.
I did. And it's something, by the way, again, it's something that's going to take some time to do. But just for a second, since you came back to that, much talk has been had about borrowing the money. You know, Donald Trump became a billionaire borrowing money. The American economic system drives itself by borrowing money, but we have to be smart about why we borrow and what we're borrowing for. And again tonight, I repeat that we have to borrow to create capital projects, translation, housing, affordable housing. You build an apartment complex, you create jobs immediately like this, you transform families that were in a homeless shelter, where the homeless shelter rates are enough to have a couple of mortgages paid for. It's ridiculous. It's irresponsible when we can have good ideas to build housing throughout New York State. So let's borrow Mr. Ravitch's idea, and let's borrow capital to build our future homes and really put people back to work.
Okay. This next question came in through the phone system. What is the senator doing about the AIDS epidemic in our district and our programs being cut?
It's a preventable disease, right? We talk about so many things that we can't prevent, but in this one instance, we know that this is a preventable disease. We need to educate, and we need to prevent, I tell you, I've been in this for 30 years, and starting in the 80s, when the AIDS epidemic hit mostly the gay community, large numbers of people say, but it doesn't affect me. It doesn't affect me. This disease doesn't take names or identify people by race, ethnicity, or sexual orientation. It is something that could be prevented. And we have to educate people on safe sex issues. We have to educate them that because your boyfriend or your husband tells you that it has to happen this way, that we have to express our love to one another this way, in this unsafe manner, that may result in preventable early deaths, you can say no. It is your right to say no. This is a lifestyle education that we have to start at the earliest grades. And yes, we have to have AIDS prevention programs be there, and we will fund those. But we will work with our parents, with our families, with our children, to make sure that they get an education in this area early and often, because this is a preventable disease. Like so many others, we all know someone who has died of AIDS. We have folks that are walking around with this time bomb because they haven't been to a primary care provider and gotten tested. I stand for universal testing for the HIV virus, which means, just like when we go for our annual physicals, you have to, in my view, after 30 years of working with doctors, they're on my side on this, make it part of the physical examination. This is not something separate and apart from who we are and our healthy bodies and minds. We have to take this seriously, educate our children early, make it part, mandatory part, of your physicals so that we can learn early, detect, and hopefully prevent these kinds of occurrences. And they're growing every day in our communities. Mostly women of color of childbearing age is where this AIDS epidemic resides now.
Okay, let's go on to the next question now. What have you done, if anything, to support some of the more vulnerable workers in our state?
I'm so glad that you raised that. I'll never forget the Friday several months ago when my wife and I and my granddaughters went to a duck farm in Liberty, New York. We thought that we were going to go there to provide and focus on farm worker rights. The labor practices of these farmers were in question. People would work without a rest day for a month, no payment for overtime. The work conditions would not separate the bathrooms for male and females. These are the kind of work conditions that Senator Honorado has introduced a bill that would correct these work conditions. But that's not all I found when I went up there. I found Latinas, South American, Mexican, Guatemalan women waiting for me outside of McDonald's parking lot. And they were crying, but they were smiling also, because they recognized, as I was introduced to them, that this was a little different, that perhaps this person, this leader, could now make a difference. Because I looked like them and I spoke their language, they were comfortable enough to tell me that they were suffering, not just them, these women, but their children. And their grandparents had suffered from sexual abuse. And so it no longer was just an issue of workplace practices. It was an issue of this kind of violence that we all say we detest, and so many people remain silent. And so we walked on to a duck farm, and I asked the owner to get on the phone, and he did. And I said, "Hi, Izzy, how you doing? I'm here." He said, "Get off my farm. You're loitering." And I say, "Sir, you are breaking a higher law, and that is that you are raping or allowing for the rape and sexual molestation of women and children on your farm. And I will leave your farm. But when I come back and when I go back to Albany, we will deal with this." And deal with this we've been doing. Kerry Kennedy, unions, all of people of conscience have united to bring attention to the plight of farm workers in this state. This is not against farmers. This is not against farmers. I want to do everything I can to make the agricultural industry in this state succeed. It is now a $4 billion industry which employs 40,000 people, but we have to do right. And so these women have been molested, sexually taken advantage of. And yes, we need to give them rest days. We need to give them the ability to have workman's compensation, disability, and the kind of facilities that all of us take for granted. That's in the legislation. We're going to do that. But I need New Yorkers and I need the Bronx to unite in our efforts to bring justice to farm workers and also domestic workers. Domestic workers who take care of our grandparents, who clean our homes and take care of our children while we're busy at work. They have no rights to. And so legislation up here is being championed by Senator Savino to bring that to the floor is my goal, to bring farm worker rights to the floor of this Senate that we're speaking from tonight is my priority. And many people make it about business. They put a price tag to people's freedoms. No moral, no financial reason will stand in our way. We have to take a vote, just like we did on marriage equality. We have to take our vote on domestic worker rights and farm worker rights. And I'm glad you asked that question.
Yeah, you know, it's a very disturbing story, what you just spoke of the farm workers. And you were at an agriculture committee hearing, and you stood up for the workers and spoke about that. And I'd like to play a clip of that right now.
All right, thanks.
Okay.
The conditions that give rise to this kind of attacks are very clear and apparent if we want to look for them and see them and care about them. When someone has total control over your existence, housing, work conditions, mid-level supervisors that speak the same language and theoretically would be there to provide some level of assistance and assimilation, are in fact perpetuating some of these crimes, it is not an easy atmosphere to negotiate for the best of us, citizens, English-speaking, etc. Imagine someone being away from their homes, working, not understanding the culture and language, but yet they were able to share all of that with me, and I think they would be able to share it with other caring listeners as well. But I do not think that we should establish the empirical case for why these things are happening. What we are being asked to as senators, as legislators, is to provide a framework of legal protections. And then the enforcement certainly needs to be buttressed, certainly needs to be accelerated and focused. But then that's for another agency. We're being asked, Mr. Chair, Madam Chair, we're being asked to look into a specific bill to provide fairness that has not been provided for many decades, that other states have provided, and then the human dilemma of sexual exploitation or what have you, I'm sure would continue to require oversight, but at least they would have the framework of protections that they now lack.
You are a staunch advocate for civil rights, that's for sure. Let's move on to another question because we only have a little bit of time left and there's plenty of questions in here. This call came in from the 800 number from Lewis. I've heard of mandate relief in the news, but what does that mean for us?
That means government and its heavy hand telling people in local governments, municipalities to do something and directing them to spend money without giving them any. And so in every area, whether it's in education, last week we passed mandate relief so that we are not telling local governments that they have to do something and not give them the resources. When that happens, Julia, when that happens, property taxes go up. The cost of living goes up for those local communities. And so we have to give them, as we should in the democratic process of government, we have to give them the ability to say no. If it is mandated by federal or state law, then that's quite another matter, as we were just talking about civil rights, as we've been talking about rights to people regardless of their sexual orientation or minorities or women. What we're talking here about is we want to micromanage local government schools, those government services that are sponsored by municipalities. We're going to tell them how to do it. It's going to cost them more, but we're not going to give them any money. And so we have to stop micromanaging, but we also have to, by way of consolidation, we can't have 700 school districts throughout the state, each one with a superintendent making $200,000, each with their own set of rules that cost money. And so the day has come when the size of government has to get smaller. And they call that being a fiscal conservative. I think that's just prudent, and that's just smart, and that's going to save people a lot of money. So, yes, no unfunded mandates, but translate that into English, it means that gets smaller, leaner, better, so that we could cost less, so that people could keep more money in their pockets.
Okay. I just want to take a break now just to tell the viewers something, you know, on the behalf of the senator and I, you know, we do appreciate your involvement in this townhouse forum. Your input's valuable, and we still have about 10 minutes left, but I'd like to ask you before you go offline tonight to tell us what you think by visiting nysenate.gov/espadatownhallfeedback. Okay? All right, now let's move on to the next question. This one says, I noticed some of the big Wall Street firms are posting profits again. How does that fit into the outlook of the budget in the short term?
Yes, I'm going to answer that question as I have others. Pero por favor, si me permite un segundito a todas las personas que están aquí transmitiendo de aquí de Albany, denos sus ideas. Tengo que comunicar con ustedes como su senador. Quiero sus ideas sobre el presupuesto y también otras cosas que le afectan la vida diaria suya y de su familia. Así que por favor. I just asked my constituents who are multilingual to please call in and give us their ideas. Bankers, of course, you know, there's a whole thing about whether or not we demonize Wall Street or we applaud them and give them more money and give them what kind of bailout plans. The truth of the matter is, and the truth sometimes is people don't want to hear or accept, but we depend. This economy, this state, depends on Wall Street for a great deal of revenue. And so a healthy Wall Street is good for our economy. However, an irresponsible Wall Street cannot be given rewards for irresponsible actions and policies and doing bad business on behalf of people that depend on them for pensions, for jobs, to give vitality to the financial sector and the state of our financial well-being in this state. So, yes, we don't need any more bailouts. There is some serious consideration being given to taxing the profits of Wall Street. That is not my idea or the state Senate's idea. It is President Obama's idea. And we want to have an open dialogue about how we can have a better relationship, a more equitable, responsible relationship between Wall Street and Main Street, because that has been seriously damaged over the actions and economic policy and practices over the last several years. Wall Street destroyed our sense of security and what we took for granted. Wall Street was smarter than anyone. The financial transactions would always yield profits. The truth of the matter is that collapse did not take place in one day, one week, or one year. It took many, many years of us looking the other way at those practices. And we have to make sure that there's oversight there, but also make sure that we understand that a healthy Wall Street, a responsible Wall Street and financial sector is very much in our plans because we need that to happen. It is responsible for over 25% of the tax revenue that we depend on.
Okay. Jose Lozano wants to ask you a question. He says, what is your office doing to help the residents of the Bronx who live in apartments where the landlords do not fix major problems in their apartments? 311 does not always help.
It does not always help. What does help is a situation like we had in Sedgwick Avenue. I forget the exact address, the 2600 block on Sedgwick Avenue, where tenants came to our office. We can't be everywhere and know everything, but when we hear of something like this, we take action. We don't just call 311, we call the Housing Preservation Department, we call any and all to make sure that that landlord knows that essential services have to be restored and provided for. In that particular instance, we took the landlord to court. He had over 800 violations, and not only just the lack of heating and hot water, but windows that were broken, alarm systems that didn't work, and the basic sanitary services were not being provided for. We took action in that instance, and we will take action in every instance, but we need to know. So we ask people to please visit our Bainbridge office and our Fordham Road office. And again, I'd like to repeat our number at Bainbridge. It's 718-652-4329. And at Fordham, it's 718-220-5480. Again, the Bainbridge office is located right across the street from the emergency room of Montefiore Hospital. And the Fordham Road office is right there on the Fordham Road, Webster Avenue. Please call us, Bainbridge, 718-652-4329, and Fordham, 718-220-5480.
Okay, time for one more quick question. Let's see. A person who didn't leave her name, but the person who took in the call said that she sounded worried. What is the Senate doing for seniors who are losing their homes due to foreclosures?
You know, this is an area that my committee, housing, and many in the Senate, we have alarms go off, not just for seniors, although that's a high priority, but for anyone that has to face foreclosure. The first thing is preventing foreclosure services. We have in the budget, I am firmly convinced that we'll be able to restore the neighborhood housing services, that will be able to provide counseling to those families that are experiencing financial distress. Don't put your head in the sand. Don't hide the problem. It won't go away. Get services early. Open up a line of communication with your bank. And the legal services that we provide out of our offices will buttress and support you as well as we avail ourselves of these foreclosure prevention services. Many times by the time you're into a foreclosure action, it's too late. So we must prevent them. But the services to prevent foreclosures were being threatened in the budget process. And I'm happy to report tonight that we're in good shape. If you keep your eye on the prize and keep the pressure on all of us up here, in good shape to restore those essential services, then neighborhood preservation programs, rural preservation programs throughout the state, are local anchors that prevent foreclosure activity.
Right. Well, Senator, I think this has been a very successful event. What do you think?
I think it's been great. I know the citizens of the Bronx appreciate it, and I just want to make sure that it's replicated many times over. So invite us back. Give us an opportunity to continue this great communication between government and the people it serves. And in this instance, very poor people who need government the most.
Yes, it was a pleasure being with you tonight.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you for being with us tonight. It was your participation that really made this all possible. New Yorkers really have a right to know where the money is, goes, and what it creates. So I hope the Senator was able to provide you with answers to help you understand for future reference. This video of the town hall will be posted on the Senator's website, espada.nysenate.gov. And he wanted to remind you that you can also reach out to the Senator through his website or call his office anytime with other ideas you come up with. Have a great night.